When I first envisioned this event, I really wanted it to be as intersectional as possible. Because so often when we have events that are centered around the Black experience, even within that, sometimes some things get more marginalized and pushed out. And actually, as a Black queer woman myself, I really wanted an event that kind of enables all Black people, whatever sort of your gender, status, or sexuality, to feel that you are, that we are also part of the Afrofuturist, the pro-Black movement. Because, yeah, we too are Black. We too believe the same as our brothers and sisters due to racism. So that's why I'm really happy that one of our performers, Travis, is here, who is an absolutely amazing individual. Absolutely, yeah, probably one of those beautiful people I've ever met. So, and I'll let you find that out over the course of the event. So, yeah, that kind of adieu, Travis.
Worlds cannot be imagined until trans, femme, Black voices are centered. Your world is not radical if gender is still pushed and forced upon me. Your world is not radical if my body that will never pass is still forced upon you. Your world is not radical if I am still shouted at on the street. So when you imagine something, imagine a world where me not being boy or girl walks past okay. Your future is not radical until trans femme voices are centered. Thank you. I do various works in spoken word and performance art, but seeing as there's all ages in the room today, I thought I'd do kind of different performances than I may normally do. So at the moment, I'm writing a children's storybook called The Queer Brown Money Kid Goes to Space. So what I'm going to do is read a couple of extracts from that, and then also a different poem as well. My lesson is not for daydreaming, wake up. The queer brown money kid shot up from the desk, brown eyes alert and muddy skin raised. The queer brown money kid cleared their throat, plucked up some bravery and said, I'm sorry, teacher, I just arrived back from space. It was magical. You what, boy? Said the teacher. Kid, teacher, I'm a kid, not a boy, and I just arrived back from space. You see, when these lessons get too much for me, when the world expectations are starting to crush down on my tiny brown shoulders, I escape. I dream. I fly into outer space, into a far-off solar system, one that you don't know about, one that no one knows about, one where the stars aren't yellow, but bright blue, one where there are no black holes, only fluffy pink space clouds, and one where right at the end, to the right and over the sour cream way, there is a planet called Pluto. The kid could tell the teacher was getting impatient, yet they quickly carried on. Pluto is similar to Pluto, teacher. It is the furthest away from the galaxy sun and is always told it isn't a planet. Pluto's identity is always argued about, scrutinized over, questioned, yet no one asks Pluto what Pluto wants. People call Pluto the dwarf planet or the big star, but no one tells Pluto that they don't have to be labelled. On Pluto, there is lots and lots of kids like me. Kids who also dreamed of a world like this. Kids that were also told off for wearing their mother's eye makeup to school. Kids that also longed for a shade of pink to only mean a shade of pink. Kids that hugged their brown skin tight and their blackness even harder. Kids that rubbed lotion on their skin with smiles as Pluto affirmed their beauty. On planet Pluto, there is no worry for kids that look like me to wear sparkles on their eyes, or for my friend Laura to play around in the mud. And on Pluto, I see people like me on the TV series and in the democratic socialist systems. Planet Pluto is the only place, teacher, that I can escape the white, heteronormative, patriarchal, transphobic, ableist system of this earth. The what system, boy? Barked the teacher, who was now getting extremely impatient and challenged by the queer brown muddy kid's radical idea of living. Pardon, teacher? I didn't mention any system. I'm only 10, and I think you must have been daydreaming. And I told you, I'm not a boy, I'm a kid. I pressed my unsmooth, big, broad hands on my even, broader shoulders, trying to ignore their size and focus on the blue sequins that fell upon them. No luck. The stubble inducing my face and the whip demanded in my pace gained far more attention than the sparkle in this dress. The hair growing up my thigh and the length of my feet were far more visible than the intricate detail within the seam. The deepness in my voice and the squelch of my bulge were heard far more clearer than the narrative I was asking to be told. No luck. Yet in my head I tried to rewind and take myself and my mind a couple of hours back in time to when I was posing in front of the mirror, serving a hot dish of realness with a fierce cup of brown, gender-fluid femboy realness. And for afters, a huge dollop of not-within-your-binary black kid killing it. Because for that moment, a couple of hours without the outside world, I was fully feeling it. I was feeling a full gale force free of Janelle, Solange, Mickey Cakes, Dark Matter, Beyonce feeling it. I was feeling damn free. Hear my genderless plea, I am free. For that moment, back in time, the blue sequins fell perfectly on my brown skin as if every rump and lump was made for each other. The black matte lippy sank onto my full mouth as if the paint was designed for the crevices of my body, and the colour of my brow shone bright as if blended into my hairs, designed by Mother Nature herself. It just felt right. I felt right. The caged body was finally free. For that moment, back in time, I was dancing on the feminine steps of my ancestors and floating past the crowds of binary. Until I stepped outside. Your feet were too big and your hair too visible, your jaw too structured, your walk too clumsy, your voice too husky, your body too trapped. Despite how I felt, despite what the mirror told me, the world needed those sequins to fit into a case. For the lipstick to be sealed in its tube and for my brows to be nice and neat. Travis, you're wearing a dress and you look fabulous, that Z formation, but are you a boy or a girl? And I love you either way and totally support you. Just please, whatever you do, don't say neither. And with that, I pressed my unsmooth, big, broad hands on my even broader shoulders and I took a sigh. I looked at them straight in the eye and head hung, went back inside and decided that maybe tomorrow, when I asked that question, I wouldn't have to decide. This thing that I hate doing when I've like put it on my phone because I haven't written it down and I hate that, but sorry. This is my last one and it is another one from the Queer Brown Muddy Kid kind of series. And it's just a short one called The Queer Brown Muddy Kid Gets Free in Their Skin. What are you doing to your skin, my darling queerling? Said the dark-skinned, melanin-rich Mother Nature. She is all wise. She knew the answer but had to hear it for herself. I'm scratching, said the queer brown, not yet muddy kid. I'm scratching at my skin. I'm peeling off the brown bits that make me feel trapped and I'm trying to find the whiteness in the flesh to feel safe. Tears were now escaping down the kid's face at a rapid speed, blending into a mixture of brown pain. Mother Nature, in all her dark glory and love, took a moment to compose herself. Mother Nature knew what was to come. Mother Nature had heard and seen this story before. Mother Nature, being of all wisdom, took a deep royal breath and said, don't scratch your skin, kid. Don't impose pain onto your glorious bumps. Your skin is your history, our herstory. Your ancestors are screaming out with love from the same skin that you pick. Your brownness is entwined with black resilience. Your melanin is rich with struggle and survival. Your skin is important, my kid. Mother Nature took the kid's hand, but they quickly released. They were not ready just yet. But the kids in my playground said I looked like mud, Mother Nature, shouted the kids tearfully. They pointed their pale hands in my face and they laughed. They said I'd never get a lover, and that I'd never get a friend, and that I'd always be less pretty than them. They said I was muddy, dirty and filthy, so let me pick, Mother Nature. Let me pick at my skin until whiteness is glowing like theirs. Let me pick at my skin until outshines the same beauty that they hold. Let me pick at my skin until I look like everyone else. Mother Nature held the queer, brown, not yet muddy kid tight in her arms of transcendent love and said, you listen to me, kid. You listen to my words carefully. Your skin is beautiful. These kids you talk of are poisoned with the same venom that is telling you that your skin is not enough. These kids you talk of are sick with an illness that tells them they are not worthy than you. These kids are not Mother Nature. Your skin, the same skin you pick at, comes from Mother Nature herself. The kid began to wipe away their tears, but could not quite shake off the system's standards. But they called me muddy. Yes, they did, said Mother Nature, her skin darkly glowing in the day, and you know what mud is? It's the foundations of our earth. Beneath our feet is mud, strong mud, holding our souls in place. Mud can be molded, crashed, and rebuilt, watered down and built back up. Mud is strong, my kid. Mud is brown in all shades of goodness and beautiful, and these same people that call you muddy put the very thing on their face to make it clearer. Mud clears things. Mud is healing. Mud, being muddy, is beautiful. These kids just noticed your strength, your wisdom, your beauty, and tried to make it, you pick at it, but instead, you will rise. Mother Nature held the kid into her breast. The kid cried and cried until their tears moisturized their now thicker skin. The kid was not healed fully, but felt that with those running tears led to a river of possibilities, the kid felt free. Free knowing that muddy held power and not hate. Free knowing that their skin held Mother Nature in its melanin and beauty in its pump. Free knowing that they were now the queer brown muddy kid, and that they were worth more than picking at their skin. Thank you.